chronic was once a tag to constrictive pericarditis, but now you have chronic constrictive pericarditis, you have subacute constrictive pericarditis, you have acute constrictive pericarditis. So that is the reason why a chronic has been put within the brackets. I will go into those details as we talk along, as much as possible, as much as the time permits. So we are going to touch on the pathophysiological basis. There are many facts which are known, there are many facts which are unknown. We are blessed with a lot of amazing technologies now, and a lot of options we have now. So things have changed. It is not as bad as it was, say, 20, 25 years back. And there are certain new things that are happening in the area of constrictive pericarditis, in the diagnostics, as well as therapeutics, also including the surgery. And before that, you need to understand a little bit about epidemiology, anatomy, epidemiology of pericardium and pericardial diseases. So when you look at the heart, everything is included within the pericardium, including the root of the aorta, proximal part of the superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, right? Except the pulmonary veins and part of the left atrium. They are not within the pericardial sac. They have an implication. This question is quite commonly asked, what is the normal thickness of pericardium? Because one of the early indications that there is something wrong with the pericardium is finding out that the pericardium is thick, either on echocardiography or CT or MRI, etc. So the normal pericardial thickness is about 1 to 2 millimeters. So anything 3 millimeters or more than 3 millimeters is definitely a thick pericardium, and more than 4 millimeter is quite common with constrictive pericarditis. It is more than 6 millimeters, almost certainly there is constriction. So what are the normal pericardial pressures? They are negative pressures, sub atmospheric minus 2 to minus 5, and you know the RA mean pressure, LA pressure, wedge pressure. So the transmural pressure, that is the gradient between the right atrial cavity pressure to intrapericardial pressure, is the transmural pressure. Now, constrictive pericarditis, there is a lot of fibrosis. It's often with thickening and with or without calcification of the pericardium. Calcification, I will touch on that a little later on, but let me just emphasize here. Calcification is not essential for the diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. Calcification is not as common as maybe you are taught in your MBBS or MD. So a very small percentage of patients have visible calcification on the chest X-ray, which may be, different people have given different numbers, but generally speaking, about 5 to 8% have visible calcification on the chest X-ray. It is better seen these days because of the digital X-rays. But if you are talking of a CT scan, nearly 20% of them have calcification of some part of pericardium. But if you are talking of a microscopic examination of the pericardium, additional 10 to 15% of the patients have microscopic calcification. So that is about the calcification of the pericardium. So absence of calcification, let me make this statement very clear here. Absence of calcification does not exclude pericardial disease, does not exclude constrictive pericarditis. Two, presence of calcification does not indicate that it is constrictive pericarditis. So absence and presence of calcification is only one parameter, but it is not a pathognomonic sign or evidence of constrictive pericarditis. We do see patients with pericardial calcification but no constriction. We see a lot of constrictive pericarditis with no calcification at all even on CT of the heart. Now the constrictive pericarditis, the basic abnormality is it is a diastolic failure. The ventricular chambers are not allowed to fill during diastole because of the non-compliant stiff pericardium. So what is the functions, normal functions of the pericardium? I remember some of my co-examiners asking, and I also remember the student suddenly blanking out. They really don't know why it is there. What is the normal function of the pericardium? So the normal function of the pericardium is, one, it protects the heart from infections. And the adjacent structures like lung, mediastinum, lymph nodes, esophagus, etc. That is one. Two, it acts as a coverage to the heart, and then the compliance of the pericardium limits the expansion of the ventricles in the diastole. So it does not allow the heart to dilate immensely, to dilate unchecked, because unchecked dilatation of the heart is not desirable. Third function is it also determines the relation between the ventricular and the atrial volume and the pressure, so-called Starling's law, for example. So these are the three main functions of the pericardium. Fourth, of course, is it maintains the shape of the heart. The shape of the heart is maintained by the pericardium. So if you look at the chest X-ray of somebody where the pericardium was taken out, so it looks like a pancake. It loses its shape, right? Next time when you look at a patient of that sort, concentrate on the shape of the heart. So surgery, as I told you, often relieves symptoms, and a good surgery, total pericardiectomy, cures the problem. So early diagnosis is important because pericardiectomy is easier when you do it early. You can just peel it away like you peel a banana. But if you wait longer, till calcium is there, till myocardium also is invaded by the fibrosis and calcium, it becomes tough. You have to go on a cardiopulmonary bypass, and you cannot do a total pericardiectomy. You have to be satisfied with a partial pericardiectomy. So obviously, the symptomatic relief will be partial or none. And obviously, the hemodynamics do not normalize. So the recurrent constrictive pericarditis is fairly common. And to do a second surgery is even more tougher. So that is the reason why early diagnosis is important. When indicated, early surgery also is important. So this is a chest X-ray and CT. This is a Mayo Clinic series. I'm sure Chandra must be very familiar with this thing. This is taken from the Mayo Clinic series of chronic constrictive pericarditis. You can see the calcification of the pericardium here, the arrows, okay, and the thick pericardium here. This thickness may be because of the inflammatory edema, it may be because of fibrosis, or it may be because of the exudate, right? And then they found that this is very interesting. This is something which everybody should be knowing. Slightly less than 20% of the constrictive pericarditis had normal thickness pericardium. Normal thickness pericardium. All of us have been under the impression that chronic constrictive pericarditis must have a thick pericardium, calcified or non-calcified. But the Mayo Clinic series first time came out with this information in a structured data of a series of constrictive pericarditis over a period of decade or decade and a half. They had two big series. This is one of the series where they have shown close to 18 to 20% of them have in fact a normal thickness pericardium with constrictive pericarditis. I want you to register that in your mind. So what are the evolving issues with constrictive pericarditis? What was constrictive pericarditis then? Then means say 20 years back and now, right? In 2019, how it has changed. But I must caution you here, whatever is being shown here is data from Mayo Clinic, which means Western population. So you cannot automatically transfer this thing to Indian population. We have very limited data on Indian population. I was also part of a study long, long back as a DM trainee in R&D Institute of Medical Sciences. But then after that, there had been cumulative experience. But this is the Mayo Western data. So then, say 20, 30 years back, the prevalent etiology of pericardial disease was idiopathic unknown. We really did not know. Then infections, could have been tuberculosis, could have been fungal, etc. And then cardiac surgery, post-cardiac surgery, 2% about. So this was then. Now, the idiopathic etiology of constrictive pericarditis has come down to less than 1/3. Then cardiac surgery has gone up, obviously for many reasons. One reason being we are doing a lot more cardiac surgery, and we are aware of the fact that it can lead to constrictive pericarditis. So we are trained to look for it, look for constriction. So we are picking up more and more of them. And then another thing has happened. Cancer has increased, radiation therapy has increased. This has happened even in India. So we see significant number of radiation-induced acute pericarditis and also good number of chronic constrictive pericarditis. There is something more about radiation constrictive pericarditis which is not a happy news, but I will touch on a little later. Though it is not indicated here, the other categories are like, for example, chronic dialysis, chronic kidney disease patients. They are now living longer. Earlier they were dying within 3 or 4 years. Now they are living longer, even decades. So as a result of that, they are developing pericarditis, azotemic pericarditis, and then leading on to chronic constrictive pericarditis. That is one more thing which is not mentioned here, but we do see once in a while if you follow them up. Then something else also is happening in the last 10 years. A lot of intrapericardial procedures are being done. Those of you who have been exposed to EP will know, right? So you are doing now intrapericardial space exploration and epicardial ablation. Epicardial ablation for VTACs, we have been doing it. And then mapping, epicardial mapping, we have been doing it. And then you're also doing a intrapericardial echocardiography. Though it is not a popular technique, that is also being done. Apart from that, left atrial appendage ligation is an intrapericardial procedure. Mitral annuloplasty, tricuspid annuloplasty, they are also being attempted through the intrapericardial space, which results in obviously pericarditis, which may, in some of them, with repeated procedures, can go into chronic constrictive pericarditis. Okay, so those are the things not mentioned here for whatever reason, but those are the things which also you need to keep in mind. Then physiology earlier was pure constriction, but now you have pure constriction, but you also have constriction plus restriction, a mixed physiology now. So who are getting that? Radiation constrictive pericarditis. Quite often they have not only just constrictive pericarditis, but also have myocardial problem. So they have a restrictive pattern as well, right? So it makes it more complicated. So radiation pericarditis and constrictive pericarditis is a mixed physiology. You need to keep that in mind. Now the diagnosis most of the time is aided, of course physical examination is important, but diagnosis is confirmed by various imaging techniques, first being echocardiography. Then sometimes, or most often, we do CT scan. Then sometimes we do magnetic resonance imaging of the heart. Rarely, we have done it half a dozen times, PET CT imaging in the pericardial disease. I will touch on that as we go along. So these are all the various things which are extremely useful in making a diagnosis. So invasive evaluation is occasionally needed, but most of the times not. So the cardiac catheterization and sometimes occasional angiography is not really done these days so often, unless you are suspecting an associated coronary artery disease. There may be coronary artery disease due to various reasons, including strangulation of the left anterior descending artery by the pericardium itself, constricting pericardium. So they may have angina, they may have coronary artery disease. We have seen a couple of these patients, particularly with radiation constrictive pericarditis. So sometimes you may have to do a invasive testing, including coronary angiography. So what's the differential diagnosis? In the previous years, 20, 25 years back, before all these amazing explosion occurred, right-sided congestive heart failure due to any cause is a differential diagnosis. It could be severe tricuspid regurgitation with heart failure, or right-sided congestive heart failure, or right atrial myxoma with right-sided congestion, etc., or restrictive cardiomyopathy, particularly right dominant restrictive cardiomyopathy, or right ventricular endomyocardial fibrosis, etc., etc., were differential diagnosis. It was tough. In fact, my first exposure to the problems of constrictive pericarditis was in 1976 in RNA Institute of Medical Sciences. Professor Goodwin from England, from London, he was visiting us. Now, I don't know how many of you heard of the name of Goodwin. Goodwin is considered the father of classification of cardiomyopathies. Dr. Goodwin, and later on, Dr. Celia Oakley. Both of them had visited us. At that time, Dr. Goodwin was visiting. We had a patient who had a total study done, cath was done, some angiogram was done, and cath lab gave a diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. Patient was waiting in the cardiac surgical ward for pericardiectomy. Then Professor Goodwin came and he used to take rounds along with us. He was with us for, if I remember right, a couple of weeks. So he saw this patient, we presented him. He said, no, no, this is not constrictive pericarditis, this is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. When Goodwin says it is hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in 1970s, when we just started hearing that there is some disease called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, obviously we believed him. Everybody believed him. Goodwin was such a big name, everybody believed him. So we discussed, then surgery was cancelled, no surgery. So Goodwin left. After Goodwin left, patient started becoming bad. It became worse and worse. Then everybody took a decision, cardiologists, cardiac surgeons took a decision. Let us open and see. So if it is constriction, we will do the pericardiectomy. If it is not, we'll take a myocardial biopsy, open chest myocardial biopsy, right? The mistake there it was, he was having pleural effusions which they did not drain before surgery. They should have, but they did not. There were instructions, but the resident did not drain the pleural effusion. So they took him up, they operated, they found it was a constrictive pericarditis untable. So they did a pericardiectomy. I don't remember whether total or partial, but pericardiectomy was done. By the, you know, those days it was among the best teams in the country, RNA Institute surgical team and CMC Vellore team. There were only two or three teams in the country. But the patient died postoperatively because of his respiratory problems, pleural effusion kind of things. So then we suddenly realized there is a huge problem in making a diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis, because if Professor Goodwin made a mistake, then it is a serious issue for us, because we can as well be making it day in and day out. So that was my first exposure to the problem of differential diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. Now we are wiser, certainly, and then we also have a lot more techniques now to sort out the issues. Some of these patients develop atrial fibrillation, chronic constriction. So it becomes a slightly a different ball game altogether when there is atrial fibrillation, and so you need to be on the lookout for that. Anybody who is coming with atrial fibrillation, one of the etiologies you have to keep in mind is constrictive pericarditis. And this is also common in restrictive cardiomyopathy. So it doesn't differentiate them, though it is more common in restrictive cardiomyopathy. I think this is the most important slide of the 1 hour plus talk. This is the most important slide. So what characterizes constrictive pericarditis? Hemodynamically. One, dissociation, this was touched on yesterday by one of my colleagues, dissociation of intrathoracic and intracardiac pressures. So the respirophasic changes which change the intrathoracic pressures are transmitted to the cardiac chambers directly. Okay? So once there is a tough pericardium around the heart, these changes in the mediastinal pressures are not transmitted to the heart in general, but they are transmitted to the pulmonary veins. Two, there is a ventricular interdependence, which means the total volume of the heart is fixed. Once there is constrictive pericarditis, okay, the total available possible volume, intracardiac blood volume of the heart is fixed. It can't change, right? So if the right ventricle is have more volume, left ventricle has to donate that volume. If the left ventricle has more volume, right ventricle has to donate that volume. So they share that volume, like you share the cake, okay? So it's a what is called as a ventricular interdependence. So when the RV volume is increasing, LV volume will go down. When the RV volume is decreasing, LV volume will go down. That is what explains your inspiration, expiration changes that come with the trans tricuspid flow and then hepatic venous flow, transmitral flow, aortic flow, and also pulmonary venous flow patterns. This is what these two things are going to decide how they behave. Third is a little contentious. The myocardial parameters need to be normal. Not only the ejection fraction, yesterday I was touching on that. Myocardial parameters is not just ejection fraction. There are significantly more information on that now. It might be a strain pattern, longitudinal, apical long axis strain pattern, or circumferential strain, or radial strain, or speckle tracking image and strain rate imaging. So all these things are also important, twist and untwist, twist angle and twist angle, twist velocity and twist velocity. So many things have come into our terminology of echocardiography. I'm sure Chandra is going to touch on that today. He has a lecture which is scheduled. But broadly speaking, normal myocardial parameters are essential to make a diagnosis of chronic constrictive pericarditis, because myocardium is not important. But if it is chronic enough, the calcium in the pericardium, fibrosis in the pericardium, can dip into the myocardium, into the subepicardial muscle layer, and then involve the muscle. So these patients may not have the typical Doppler echo patterns of chronic constrictive pericarditis. This is something which you need to remember. And this also has an implication. If there is a myocardial involvement, symptomatic improvement is not very good after surgery, and the long-term mortality morbidity figures are worse if there is myocardial involvement. Surgery itself is difficult because you have to do it on cardiopulmonary bypass, and then when the surgeon is trying to strip the heart of the pericardium, he might tear the chambers, so it may require again repair. So they are best done on a cardiopulmonary bypass, and you need to be very, very careful while you are stripping. So these are the normal hemodynamics which we have been talking about. So in a patient who has a normal pericardium, there is an inspiratory decrease in the intrathoracic pressure, which is uniformly transmitted to the lungs and the cardiac chambers. So what happens in the left heart during the inspiration? There is a decrease in the stroke volume, increase in the systolic blood pressure, and then increase in the pulse pressure, and then decrease in the ventricular ejection time, and Q2 and A2 interval measurement also is decreased. Mitral EV velocity also is decreased during inspiration. The reverse happens during expiration. Okay, so during inspiration all these parameters will decrease, during expiration all these parameters will increase. So what are the echo Doppler findings which are very very important, should put you on caution? One, thickened pericardium, as I told you, more than 3 or more than 3 millimeters, and then dilated inferior vena cava, and then septal bounds. This is very easy to appreciate. If I have time, I will show you an example. Septal bounds. Abnormal septal motion is one of the important characteristics of constrictive pericarditis. Point two, abnormal motion may also be seen in many other conditions, like for example, left bundle branch block or coronary artery disease, so on and so forth. So there are three types of ventricular septal motion abnormalities in constrictive pericarditis. One is because of the ventricular interdependence, there is a septal bounce. During inspiration, ventricular septum bows towards left ventricle. During expiration, it bows towards the right ventricle. Okay, that is one. That is quite common. Second thing is, there is a septal shudder, multiple movements of the ventricular septum. Septal shudder. In septal shudder, the hemodynamics behind septal shudder are, one, there is rapid crossover of the pressures between left ventricle and right ventricle multiple times. So that results in multiple movements of the ventricular septum. So that goes by description of a septal shudder. This septal movements and abnormalities of the septal movements are best seen if you do a color MOD. If you do a color MOD, I have some examples. If you do a color MOD, you can see these things very nicely. Third abnormality which you might see is a diastolic septal notch. In the early diastole, there is a septal notch. So these three are the septal motion abnormalities. Among them, the septal bounce is very easily appreciated by the naked eye. Septal shudder is easily appreciated by a color MOD, right? And then you have the Doppler data. There is an exaggerated respiratory variation of E velocity, early diastolic velocity, exaggerated mitral inflow E by A ratio, and tissue Doppler imaging of the annular velocities are important. I will show you some examples. And there is a blunted diastolic IVC flow with expiration. And then there is a diastolic flow reversal in the hepatic veins. That is a very, very important finding because it almost is diagnostic of chronic constrictive pericarditis. Diastolic expiratory flow reversal in the hepatic veins. And then flow patterns across mitral valve, pulmonary veins, and hepatic veins, and tricuspid valve are also very important. But when you are doing an echocardiographic study, I must admit that I insist, but rarely they do, even in our lab, most of the time they don't have any ECG tracing. You need to have an ECG reference tracing on your monitor along with the echo study, and also respiratory movement graph, respirogram, what you call as a pneumogram or respirogram, you must have. But that is an optional parameter which they sell with the echo machines, not standard. You can buy it, but it is important. Particularly in this condition, it is extremely important. If you don't have it, just tie one of the ECG leads over the abdomen. Then that will show you when the abdomen is inflating, when the abdomen is deflating by the baseline, which is shifting up and down, if you don't have the respirometer. But it is important to have both ECG reference and respiratory phase reference. Now, No, some of the important things we know about constrictive pericarditis now came into our knowledge with the original work of Liv Hatley, and she is the one who published this paper in 1989 and demonstrated that there is a dissociation between intracavitary LV endastolic pressure and intrathoracic pressures as measured by the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure then at that point in time. She also has found out the exaggerated LV and RV interdependence, what we are now calling as a ventricular interdependence. These are two parameters which are extremely important for the diagnosis are first originally demonstrated and published by Liv Hatley. I think Dr. Chandra also worked with her, some of her. She worked in Mayo for some time. They had a collaborative study on various things. I met her in Madrid. I had a photograph, I was searching for it, I thought I can show you. So, a dissociation between intrathoracic and intracavitary pressures. So there is a ventricular interdependence, which means that interventricular septum is free to move. How it moves, I told you the three abnormal movements of that. Then you look at the pulmonary vein, mitral valve, and hepatic vein, right? So in pulmonary valve, you have a systolic flow signal and diastolic flow signal, right? Then during inspiration, the expiration, you have both, right? Then mitral valve, similar thing, E and A, and hepatic veins, systolic, diastolic. In expiration, there is a diastolic flow reversal. This finding is considered, though I don't really have any numbers of my own, is generally considered to be 100% specific for constrictive pericarditis. Diastolic flow reversal in hepatic veins during expiratory phase. And here you have a demonstration of ventricular interdependence. You see here, normally when the right ventricular volume is decreasing, I think I have one more example, maybe you can appreciate it better. Maybe I'll talk about that a little bit. Now this is septal bounce which we are talking about. It says septal bounce is a brisk early diastolic ventricular septal motion. During inspiration it moves towards the LV, during expiration it goes to the RV side. This is the respiratory there, which is essential. And then there is the ECG, which is also essential as a reference tracing. See the movement of that. So this is inspiration. This is expiration. Okay? Yeah, probably this, you may be able to see it better. This is also from Hatley's publication. You see the left ventricular pressure, right ventricular pressure. Right? Now, during inspiration, the left ventricular peak pressure is dropping, the RV pressure is increasing. That is because they are sharing the same volume of the blood. The reverse happens during expiration. So during expiration, the LV systolic pressure is higher, RV pressure is lower. Right? Are you able to get it? Because it's a very important concept for constrictive pericarditis. The simple reason being that they are sharing the same fixed volume of the blood. Here I must caution you about something. This is not always seen. This is classically seen only in a subtype of chronic constrictive pericarditis. That is what is called as a rigid shell chronic constrictive pericarditis. Rigid shell chronic constrictive pericarditis. More common constrictive pericarditis is a elastic chronic constrictive pericarditis, where pericardium has decreased its compliance but has not become totally rigid. It still moves pericardium. So you don't see this classically in elastic constrictive pericarditis. You see it classically in rigid shell. you look at this is the caudal mode which I was talking about. The septal motion abnormalities are very nicely seen in constrictive pericarditis if you take the caudal mode. Look at the inspiration. When there is an inspiration, what is happening is septum is moving towards the left ventricle. During expiration, septum is moving towards the right ventricle. Okay, so this is what is commonly referred to as the ventricular interdependence and the septal bounds. This is not septal shudder, this is septal bounds. Now what happens to the right heart flows? Look at the tricuspid valve, inspiration, expiration. During inspiration, there is an increase in the E-wave velocity across the tricuspid valve flow, diastolic flow. During expiration, it decreases, right? Now look at the RV outflow tract. Similar thing happens during inspiration. RV outflow, flow velocity increases. During expiration, it decreases. This is only a reflection of what is happening at the tricuspid valve. Now what happens in superior vena cava? It is important. Superior vena cava flows can be very nicely studied, provided you do it from a I do it from the right supraclavicular window. You see the superior vena cava very nicely, see the flows very nicely, and you will get an excellent Doppler pattern of the superior vena cava from the right supraclavicular window, right? So now what happens in COPD, you know, one of the differential diagnoses of pulses paradoxes is bronchial asthma, COPD, chronic smokers, etc. So in COPD, during inspiration, actually the flow increases by more than 20%. Whereas chronic constrictive pericarditis, it does not increase at all, or there is a very minimal increase. Right? So this is important to differentiate this lung problem versus constrictive pericarditis. Systemic vein flow, we talked about hepatic vein, same thing is again demonstrated here. Inspiration, expiration, this is expiration, this is diastolic. You see the diastolic reversal wave. Very prominent diastolic flow reversal in the hepatic vein during expiration. So that is a very, very important finding, which makes the diagnosis near certain. But remember, you need to have an ECG, you need to have a respirogram, otherwise you can't make it out. Now what happens in the pulmonary vein? So you have inspiration and expiration here, inspiration, then expiration. So during expiration, the flow in the pulmonary veins increase. So you have the systolic flow increasing, diastolic flow also is increasing. During the inspiration, you see that much less. Compare this inspiratory pulmonary venous flow to expiratory pulmonary venous flow. So there is a tremendous increase in the pulmonary venous flow during expiration. Same thing happens across the mitral valve, same thing happens across the aortic valve, same thing happens across the LVOT, same thing happens in the, if you sample the abdominal aorta or thoracic aorta. Look at the mitral valve flows, the same thing is reflected here. You see inspiration and expiration, look at the velocities. During inspiration they are much low, during expiration they are increasing. But this increase in expiration, there are some cutoffs, so it should at least be 25% more than during inspiration. Then only we would consider it as a diagnostic point. So this E velocity should be more than 25% of E velocity during inspiration. Then only it can be taken as a useful parameter. Similar thing happens across the LVOT. Similar thing happens in the aorta. Same inspiratory, expiratory changes. So pulmonary vein, mitral valve, LVOT, aortic valve, aorta. Similar changes. Then tricuspid valve, RV, RVOT, pulmonary artery, similar changes. Okay. This I think we have already talked about. diastolic flow reversal, expiration more than the inspiration. See here, there is a small systolic reversal here, slightly bigger diastolic reversal here. This is during inspiration. During expiration, see the diastolic flow reversal, which is increasing. Whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, the behavior is completely different, because the increase is more during inspiration than during expiration. Right? That example I'm going to show you. The same thing we are showing here. But there is a cutoff. So just because it increases in expiration does not make it a valuable sign. It has to be more than 25%. The reversed flow should be more than 25% of forward flow in the hepatic way. Then only it is a diagnostic parameter. Whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, both systolic reversal and also diastolic reversal both increase, as you can see here. Both increase. This is inspiration, this is expiration. See, both of them increase. That's how you differentiate. I think this next 3 or 4 slides summarize what we have been talking about. This is a respiratory variation in mitral valve flow. Normally what happens? Constriction, what happens? Restrictive myocardial disease, what happens? What is not depicted here is some of the constrictions have a myocardial disease also, that is not shown. So this is the same thing across the tricuspid valve flow, we discussed in detail. This is across the pulmonary venous flow. This is across the hepatic venous flow. Normal constriction, restrictive cardiomyopathy. This is again from Hadley's work, published in JACC, one of the original papers on this. From Mayo Clinic, as you can see. So these are the 3 important parameters they highlighted in that publication in mid-90s. Mitral inflow, which is the velocity is increasing during expiration. Tricuspid velocity is increasing by more than 40% during inspiration. Hepatic vein, diastolic flow reversal during expiration. These are the 3 important things they have brought out in that particular paper in Circulation. Now, there is something else. There are, they found, the same paper, they found that a group of 12 patients, constriction was confirmed by every means, including surgery, but no classical findings. No classical findings. Classical findings, we talked about it. But in their large group, there were 12 patients who had constriction, undoubted, but did not have the classical echo Doppler findings. They found that these are the groups who are mixed constriction with restriction, that is myocardial involvement by the fibrotic calcific pericardium. Okay, and marked increase in the preload. Suppose if the patient is in congestive heart failure, you don't see all these mitral valve flow changes, tricuspid valve flow changes, pulmonary vein flow changes. So then you may not make a diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. So in these patients who are in congestive heart failure, you need to give diuretics. Then re-study them for the classical findings of constriction. That is one way of doing it. Another way of doing it, short of giving diuretics, is study them in sitting posture. Normally we study them in supine posture. You don't have classic pattern, then make them sit up. By making them sit up, you are reducing the preload, because pulmonary venous flow is decreased. So by reducing the preload, you may be able to bring out the respirophasic changes which are typical for constrictive pericarditis. So that should be part and parcel of your echocardiographic examination, right? Another important finding is, in restrictive myocardial disease, mitral valve peak E wave, you know, you have E prime and A, E prime wave is, as a general rule, less than 8 centimeters. some people quoted 7, some people quoted 8, less than 8 centimeters. Whereas in construction, almost always it is more than 8 unless there is involvement of the myocardium as well. This is a very easy parameter and very reliable parameter, easy to get it. So remember it. Cut off 8. The same thing has been shown here. Michelin-Endless tissue velocity. This is normal. This is myopathy, cardiomyopathy. This is constrictive pericarditis. You can see that the E velocities are decreased. You see here, E velocity is increased. Same thing can be demonstrated on the longitudinal strain also. Now, there is something more which we are going to talk about. Mitral annulus reverses. Normally, in a normal heart, right, also in myopathic heart, lateral annulus E velocity is more than the E velocity of the medial annulus, right? Generally, at least 20% more than, 10 to 20% more than medial annulus E velocity in normal hearts and in myopathic hearts, right? But when there is constrictive pericarditis, this is reversed because pericardium is covering the anterolateral wall of the left ventricle and also right ventricle in a global constriction. What happens is the heart is not allowed to expand. Because heart is not allowed to expand, the annulus lateral velocities will be less. As a result of lack of expansion laterally, ventricle expands in constrictive pericarditis longitudinally. So as a result of that, the medial annulus velocities are increased. So they will be more than that of the lateral annulus velocity. This can be demonstrated on the mitral valve annulus, can be demonstrated in the tricuspid valve annulus in a global constriction. But if it is a regional constriction only on the left side, then only mitral annulus will show. If the regional constriction only on the right side, only tricuspid valve annulus will show this annulus reversal. This is called annulus reversal. This always gets normalized after good pericardiectomy. This always gets normalized after good pericarditis. So, if postoperatively annulus reversus is not normalized, if it continues to be present, it means that either pericarditis was not done or inadequately done. Right? Which means long term results are not good, recurrent constrictive pericarditis is more than possible. Now, this annulus reversus, mitral valve, tricuspid valve, pulmonary vein flows, etc., even hepatic vein flow, all of them, same parameters, abnormal parameters, are preserved even if the rhythm is atrial fibrillation. Same findings will continue to be present even in the presence of atrial fibrillation. Pulsus paradox, this is something which all of you know, inspiratory fall of the systolic blood pressure more than 10 millimeters, you call it as a pulsus paradoxus. This in echo lab you can nicely demonstrate by taking, by sampling either abdominal aorta or ascending aorta. So you can demonstrate very nicely. Another thing which is worthwhile remembering is respiratory variability in flow across all these chambers, they also depend on other variables like depth of breathing. You will find patients in echo lab, when you ask them to take a proper breath, they won't. Suddenly they become very conscious, they stop breathing or they do erratic breathing or shallow breathing. So then your data may not be dependable. So you have to train them well for this procedure. So depth of breathing is important. Level of left atrial pressure. If the left atrial pressure is very high, like you have in congestive heart failure or even in chronic constrictive pericarditis, if the left atrial pressure is more than 30, all these respirophasic changes will not be seen. Okay, that is a problem. So you should try to reduce the left atrial pressure pharmacologically or by dynamic positional changing, like I told you, see, making them sit up or making them stand up, etc., etc., try to reduce the LA pressure. Then the classical pattern may emerge. The severity of the constriction, the more severe the constriction, the higher will be the LA pressure. Higher is the LA pressure, the less likelihood that you will get the classical respirophasic changes in this hemodynamic. So what are the difficulties in diagnosis? Atrial fibrillation sometimes is difficult because auscultation itself is difficult in atrial fibrillation. But echocardiographic findings, particularly the respirophasic changes, do not alter. They remain abnormal even in the presence of atrial fibrillation. Severe constrictive pericarditis, rigid shell constrictive pericarditis, you don't find these respirophasic changes. So you need to be conscious of that. And constriction with large left ventricle, the cavities of the LV and RV are very large due to whatever reason, or the associated valvular heart disease. Again, the respirophasic patterns, echo Doppler, tissue velocity pattern, all that will go haywire. They may not be dependable. If there is a mixed constrictive pericarditis and myocardial involvement, it is possible in small percentage of patients, particularly calcific chronic constrictive pericarditis. Again, classical findings may not be there, and the combined disease of pericardium, myocardium is more common with radiation constrictive pericarditis and post cardiac surgery. 2% to 3% of post cardiac surgery develop constrictive pericarditis as early as 1 month, as late as 20 years after surgery. Renal failure and dialysis patients also have a similar problem. So, and somebody may have a COPD and also restrictive cardiomyopathy. Combined COPD and restrictive cardiomyopathy. So some features of constriction may be there because of COPD. Some features of cardiomyopathy may be there because of restrictive cardiomyopathy. Then you are in a bind. So you need to be aware of all these things to be able to decipher. So this is what we have been talking about, septal motion, restrictive mitral valve flow velocity during inspiration and expiration, hepatic vein diastolic reversal with expiration, and then medial E velocity more than lateral E velocity in patients with constrictive pericarditis. It is a very useful thing to know whether it is a constrictive pericarditis or cardiomyopathy, or whether proper pericardectomy has been done or not. But I must caution you here. This is not always reliable. Okay? If somebody had a lateral wall infarct, the lateral annulus velocity will be low. Medial annulus velocity may be normal or increased. There may be no constriction, but lateral MI, myocardial infarct. That is one situation. Second situation is mitral annular calcification. If there is a lot of mitral annular calcification, mitral annulus is rigid, it doesn't move at all. So if that is so, all these velocities, findings, you may not get. Or third, there may be calcification of the mitral annulus only laterally, but not medially. If that is so, then again, the lateral velocity will be low, but medial velocity will be normal or high. Or if the calcification is of the medial annulus, lateral annulus is normal, then again it may mimic the normal or may mimic the constrictive pericarditis. So, mitral annular calcification and the lateral wall, myocardial integrity also need to be kept at the back of your mind when you are studying this. This is a speckle track imaging in a patient with constrictive pericarditis. This is preoperative. You can see here this gap here. This is LV antral atrium. This is RV free wall. Well, constriction is very common in the free wall, because commonest where the fluid gravitates out of pericardial effusion into the AV group, and then into the lateral side. So that is where you will find most constriction, most calcification when they are present. You can compare it with preoperative and postoperative. This is preoperative strain, this is after pericardectomy, good pericardectomy. You see the arrows. There is no strain here, there is a good strain here. Again, RV free wall, no strain. You see a good strain. It's a parametric carpet image. So there is a group of constriction without significant respiratory variation, transmitral Doppler. So you have a constrictive pericarditis suspected, however, no significant variation in transmitral early velocity, EVA velocity. So some patients still have significant respiratory variation in pulmonary venous Doppler. So if you are not happy with the mitral valve flows, study the pulmonary venous flows. Okay, so they are probably give you important clues. You can do the transthoracic in a good window or transesophageal in a bad sonic window. The possibilities, as we talked about earlier, very shallow breathing or very high left atrial pressure more than 30 millimeters or a mixed physiology, constrictive plus myopathic physiology. So markedly elevated LA pressure more than 30 will attenuate the transmitral respiratory variation. So repeat the Doppler after reducing the preload, do it in sitting position or standing position, or give diuretic and then repeat the study. So see, here is a supine study, this is a sitting study. In supine study, you are not finding the whatever you expected across the mitral valve. This is a patient with constrictive pericarditis. And then this is the patient with heart failure. So he is made to sit up. As soon as he sits up, when the mitral Doppler is repeated, you find the classical change happening during expiration, increasing mitral valve flow velocity. There is another what is called as the annulus paradoxus. Right? Annulus paradoxus means when the left atrial pressure is, in spite of the left atrial pressure being high, mitral valve E velocity is increased. Sorry, there is some call coming. Right? Normally speaking, when the left atrial pressure is very high, transmitral E flow velocity is expected to be decreased. But in constrictive pericarditis, this will be very high. E flow velocity will be very high, even though left atrial pressure is elevated. Alright? So, this is what is called as the annulus paradoxus. Again, this is not only the diagnostic sign of constrictive pericarditis, it is also a useful sign to know whether pericardectomy has been adequately done or not. This should disappear postoperatively. This should disappear. If it does not disappear, these two signs, it means that pericardectomy was not done or not adequately done, or the whatever it is. Sometimes surgeons remove the pericardium where it easily comes out, where actually it is adherent and constricting. They find it difficult, they find it safe not to do it, because they might tear the chamber wall or they might tear the coronaries, averse the coronaries, so they leave it behind. So for the surgeon, the most important is the patient should leave the hospital alive. Done or not done is a different matter. Okay? So this is a study which was published, mitral annular velocity, early diastolic mitral annular velocity. You can see here, this is a constrictive pericarditis, this is amyloid cardiomyopathy, this is a primary restrictive cardiomyopathy, this is a cutoff. The so-called cutoff I was talking about, 7 or 8 is that. So above that, you have a clear cut constrictive pericarditis, below that, clear cut cardiomyopathy. But this does not apply to mixed disorders. Good pericarditectomy normalizes, I did not add the word good, but it should be there. Good or adequate pericarditectomy normalizes respiratory flow abnormalities across right chambers, across left chambers. Annulus paradoxes should disappear. Annular inverses should disappear. Strain rate should come back to normal. Okay? And then persistence of these abnormalities mean that pericarditectomy was not done or incomplete, or this patient will have a long-term recurrent constriction and morbidity mortality are high. So this is a summary from Mayo Clinic. Many things have been added later on. I will not go into this. We have already discussed about it. This also you saw yesterday. Professor Sudha Kumar was showing this thing. Systolic area change showing the ventricular interdependence. Do you remember his slide yesterday? It's something similar. Systolic area of the right ventricle and the left ventricle during inspiration and during expiration, and take a ratio. If it is more than 1.1 or more than 1.1, it is considered 100% diagnostic of constrictive pericarditis. But to be very honest, I have never done that, so I have no comment to make. Maybe Chandra will say something after that, because it takes time, and this is an invasive thing. These days we are not doing much of invasive things for constrictive pericarditis. But the same thing has been demonstrated again. So its predictive accuracy is 100%, specificity is 100%, sensitivity is 97%, negative predictive accuracy is 95%. So this is almost like what you call gold standard or platinum standard for constrictive pericarditis. Whether it is true or not, I don't know, because I have never done that. There are some variants of, just take a few more minutes, my time is up there. There are some variants. You need to remember about the variants, because they do happen these days because of post-surgical constrictive pericarditis, because of radiation constrictive pericarditis. So many things, many variations of the classical constrictive pericarditis have been happening. We also have seen, I have a lot of examples, but time does not permit to go into that. So constrictive pericarditis, we have two important things. One is, as I told you, elastic, where pericardium still is expandable. Okay, it behaves differently. Rigid shell constrictive pericarditis, where pericardium is thick, fibrotic, calcific, and then cardiac, intracardiac volume is absolutely fixed to the milliliter. It can't change. That is rigid shell. So they have different physical characters, they have different hemodynamics. Occult constrictive pericarditis means there are no echocardiographic signs of constrictive pericarditis, but there is constrictive pericarditis. This happens if there is hypervolemia, like congestive heart failure. It also happens if there is hypovolemia. So these patients, to bring out the occult constrictive pericarditis into clinical parameters, diagnostic, if there is CHF, give diuretic, or examine them in standing position. Okay? Two, if there is hypovolemia, give a fluid challenge. Give a fluid challenge and repeat either invasive pressures or Doppler parameters. Another character is effusive constrictive pericarditis. This is fairly common, about 12 to 15%. Subacute effusive constrictive pericarditis. But diagnosis is not always easy. You know for certain it is subacute effusive constrictive pericarditis only after you have taken out the fluid, but still the RA pressure is high. Then you know it is an effusive constrictive pericarditis. There are some clues on echocardiography, some clues on MRI, all right. But broadly speaking, making a clinical diagnosis is somewhat difficult. Then acute reversible, this is important, acute reversible constrictive pericarditis. Some people have an acute pericarditis, also have features of constriction. So these are the people who have severe inflammation of the pericardium, including the visceral layer of the pericardium. And this thick inflamed visceral layer gets stuck to the epicardial myocardium and constricts the heart, right? So this is the one which is potentially reversible. This is the one which is potentially reversible with anti-inflammatory drugs like indomethacin or corticosteroids, etc., etc. But you need to make out that. So how do you make out that? So if there is constrictive pericarditis and pericarditis, acute pericarditis, you suspect that it may be reversible when the inflammatory markers are positive, then you do a magnetic resonance imaging and there is late gadolinium enhancement of the pericardium. If that is so, just giving them either indomethacin or corticosteroids will normalize the constrictive physiology in less than a month. We have a good series of patients of our own where we have done MRI and we have demonstrated the reversal of the constriction with purely medical therapy, no surgery. Some of these people were sent for surgery by some other centers and they come to us, we do the MRI, occasionally we do PET, demonstrate inflammation, then give steroids, then it reverses, then we re-study them. So remember this, because the importance of acute reversible constrictive pericarditis is, it is easy to diagnose, you need to do only inflammatory markers like CRP, ESR, and then, if possible, interleukin. Then do a MRI, gadolinium enhancement MRI, if possible, PET MRI, right? And it is totally reversible. No surgery is required. Treatment is pretty simple. Another group which I have shown you, that about less than 20% of them have thickness of the pericardium normal, but still there is constrictive pericarditis. So don't take thickness of the pericardium only as a important parameter. Look at the other things also. So nearly 1/5 of the patients have a normal thickness pericardium. Regional constriction. The usual constriction is global constriction. Regional constriction can involve superior vena cava, so SVC RE obstruction will be there, or it may be tricuspid valve stenosis. The fibrosis in the annulus extends into the tricuspid valve, right, from the AV group, or RV mid cavity obstruction we have seen, RV OT obstruction we have seen, and then constriction of the main pulmonary artery, mimicking pulmonary stenosis. That also we have seen. And we also have seen mitral stenosis secondary to constrictive pericarditis. Then we have seen LVOT obstruction. We also have seen left anterior descending entrapment arteriopathy. So there is a pericardium which entraps the left anterior descending and produces angina and ischemia. These people may require surgery, a bypass to that, along with pericarditis. So this can be a regional constriction. Just like regional cardiac tamponade, there can be a regional constriction. Sometimes only pulmonary veins are involved. Then these people have recurrent pulmonary edema. When you do the echo, everything looks all right. But they have a recurrent pulmonary edema, severe symptoms because of pulmonary veno-occlusive disease, secondary to regional constriction. Then constrictive pericarditis with myocardial involvement. This I have been talking about, it's a mixed physiology. Keep that in mind. There are some mimics. Primary cardiac lymphoma can mimic just like constrictive pericarditis. I can remember at least 3 patients of cardiac lymphoma. One was secondaries from melanoma. We made a diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis, sent them to the surgeon for pericardiectomy, only to get a call from the operating theater that there is a mass, there is pericardium is not visible at all. So it was a lymphoma. So when the lymphoma surrounds the heart, it constricts the heart. Right? So please keep in mind, sometimes primary cardiac lymphomas, pericardial mesothelioma, we operate on one mesothelioma, which we thought was constrictive pericarditis, but turned out to be a mesothelioma. There were a lot of findings suggesting mesothelioma in echo, cardiac CT. We also did an angiogram in that patient, but all those red flags were blinded. Nobody noticed them. After we knew it was mesothelioma, we went back and studied. It was a classical echo, classical CT, classical angio, and half dozen people had seen, including me, and all of us were blind to them. We did not make out. So just a few words about elastic constrictive pericarditis and rigid shell. The paradoxical pulse is more often seen in rigid shell chronic constrictive pericarditis, not common with elastic. Okay. Similar to JVP forms, the Y descent is very predominant, and X descent may not be dominant, may not be seen well in rigid shell constrictive pericarditis. Calcification is usually absent in elastic constriction, whereas calcification is often present in chronic rigid shell constrictive pericarditis. Pericardial effusion sometimes is present with elastic constriction, but always absent in rigid shell because it is very, very chronic in 2 years and maybe even decades. P waves on the ECG are usually normal in elastic CP, but in rigid shell, atrium also is invaded. So there may be a wide P wave or tall P wave or notched P wave, etc. Then atrial fibrillation and atrial arrhythmias are far more common with rigid shell constrictive pericarditis, but not so common with elastic type. So this is about pericardial inflammation and MRI, just to demonstrate. MRI is a critical issue, weight gathering and enhancement. So reversible constrictive pericarditis was associated with pericardial and systemic inflammation. So inflammatory markers may be found. So when you do a gadolinium enhancement MRI, you will find the pericardium which is inflamed, taking a lot of gadolinium. Same thing happens with PET imaging also. It takes up a lot of FDG. So this is an example of from Mayo Clinic. This is reversible acute constrictive pericarditis before steroid treatment, after steroid. Look at the pericardium. Before treatment. After steroid therapy of 6 to 8 weeks, this is the pericardium. So they dramatically improve. Anyway, the following 3-4 slides are summary of what we have discussed, comparing constrictive pericarditis with restrictive cardiomyopathy. I will not go into the details because all this has been already discussed. Summarizing, dissociation of intrathoracic pressures from intrapericardial chambers is one of the defining characters of constrictive pericarditis. Because of the limited diastolic volume due to fibrosis pericardium, there is an exaggerated ventricular interaction. That is the second very important defining character of constrictive pericarditis. And many of these features can be demonstrated on well done echocardiogram. But you must have ECG reference, you must have respirograph. Cardiac cath is rarely needed, maybe less than 10% of the patients will require a cardiac cath. If the echo data is not conclusive, patients are in atrial fibrillation, if there is a mismatch between echo and clinical studies, or if you want to look at the coronary arteries, then maybe you could go ahead and then do a cardiac cath and then coronary angiogram. I think with that,